I suspect he'll have a fight at 75 first to get his feet wet in the division, and then see who he'd want to, you know, what names at the top he would make an opponent for. Not that he views himself as an opponent, an undefeated middleweight titleist, but he would likely be the underdog against either one of these, though certainly against Bivol or Kovalev or the elite of the division.
Max, this is Jaime with All Access Elite Boxing. I want to ask you a question about Oscar Valdez. Leading up to this fight, we spoke with Oscar 2 days prior to the fight. He mentioned to us that, you know, when he suffered his broken jaw in the ring, the hardest part about that fight wasn't the fight itself. It was after the fight when he had his mouth wired shut for 2 months. He said he suffered from a panic attack and thought he was going to die the first 2 days. Coming back from the ring 11 months, how would you assess his performance tonight, considering that he's joined the likes of Eddie Reynoso?
Valdez is a very good fighter. He would make a very good fight with any of the 26-pounders. They put him in with the right guy tonight. You know, Top Rank has been, and I'm not just saying this because I'm at ESPN and Top Rank's at ESPN, I'll give it to you straight. Top Rank has been the most successful promoter in the history of boxing. Aaron's been doing this since the 70s, right? When he was there with Don King, Don King was actually the most dominant promoter, but that was done on the cult of his personality. Aram and now Todd DeBuff have a structure in place and have been nonstop the most successful or one of the two most successful promotional outfits, even as the landscape has changed, for 50 years, right? So one of the reasons for that is they have very, very good matchmakers. Bruce Trampler and Brad Goodman are as good as it gets. Carl Moretti works at the company, he's not even a matchmaker, and he was an excellent matchmaker. So they put him in right. They put Valdez in with a guy, Tomasoni, who can't hit at all, whose technique isn't even very good. And it's not that Valdez didn't deserve it. He had three tough fights. You don't put a guy in a killer fight after killer fight. You need to get him some rounds, get his confidence back, the whole, especially coming off a busted jaw. So, but that is the reason I think Valdez looked as good as he did first fight back like that. Because he was with a guy who was a soft touch. That is true. Valdez is a good fighter. He's a very good fighter. I thought he looked calm, which was, you know, one of the things you're looking for in a situation like that, when he may be a little, you know, let me test the jaw, let me see what it feels like. He looked calm. He boxed very well. He mixed it up to the head and body. He flashed knockout power. He's a very good fighter, and even though Frampton doesn't have the belt anymore, if you can't make a fight for a unification of belts, a fight with Frampton and Valdez would be really fun to watch. And any fight at 26 involving Valdez would be fun to watch.
What would you think he would have to do, in a sense, to fight a Leo Santa Cruz, a Warrington, a Gary Russell Jr.? When we spoke to Oscar at the weigh-ins, he mentioned that those are the types of fights that he wants, his promoter wants, and that they're willing to make. What do you think it's going to take for those fights to happen?
Well, I mean, promoters and networks are going to have to come to some understanding. And if the money is there, they'll figure out a way to divvy it up. I don't see any of the fighters you just mentioned as kind of long-term cash cows, in the sense that none of them look like blue-chip, pound-for-pound type fighters. But they're all good fighters. Of the fighters you mentioned, think of how many permutations of those guys make fun, evenly matched fights. So from that point of view, there's no reason not to make those fights. So I think there is a good chance that at least some of the permutations of the fighters you mentioned